Danger, Tiger Crossing by Lynn Oliver. Chapter 3. No one answered, so I rang the bell again. Still nothing.
I told you no one comes to the door, Luna said. Let's just go.
Wait, I'm going to try one more thing. Lifting up the rusty old door knocker that was shaped like a paintbrush, I pounded on the door 5 or 6 times.
Hello in there, I called out. I've come for my helicopter.
I thought I heard something moving inside, footsteps scurrying around. I guess I should say hoof steps, because I had a feeling that's what they were. The door opened just a crack, enough for me to see an orange pig snout sticking out.
Apologies, Chive said. I didn't mean to run off with your toy, but the mistress can be an impatient woman.
You mean Viola Dots? Luna said. We'd love to meet her.
I'm afraid that will be impossible, he answered. Mrs. Dots does not receive visitors. However, if you wait here, I will get your helicopter, which I have placed upstairs for safekeeping.
The snout disappeared, leaving the door slightly open.
Are you thinking what I'm thinking? Luna asked. Because if you are, I wouldn't do it.
That's the difference between you and me, I answered. I pushed on the door, and it swung open.
Come on, I said. Let's take a quick look around. We'll be back on the porch by the time Chives come back downstairs.
I had assumed that the living room would be dark and dusty, full of creepy old furniture, but it was just the opposite. The inside was one huge room. There was no furniture at all. Lots of dangling crystal lights hung down from the ceiling.
Wow, Luna whispered. It's all twinkly in here like a fairy tale castle.
Big paintings of every kind leaned against the walls. One showed tall stacks of golden hay. Another was a wild-looking starry night with crazy splotches of blue and yellow. There was even one naked lady standing in what looked like a giant clamshell. On the biggest wall hung a huge golden frame. It was old and dusty, carved with rabbits and owls and pigs and angels. All the creatures were connected by leafy trees and bunches of grapes. On the bottom of the frame, there was the fanciest clock I'd ever seen. It was made of gold, just like the two birds that were holding it. The clock didn't seem to work, though. The hands said 5 o'clock. I checked my watch. It was 10 to 4. Batman was never wrong. Inside the golden frame was a painting that sent a shiver down my spine. There was something about it that seemed so frightening, like being in the middle of a bad dream. It was a picture of a tiger crouched in a thick green jungle. His yellow eyes were wide and glowing, and his sharp teeth looked like they were dying for something to bite. It felt like that tiger was going to jump out of the frame and pounce on me at any second.
What exactly is the meaning of this?
I knew that voice, old and shrill, could only belong to Viola Dots. She burst into the room and marched up to us, her face set in a deep frown. She was wearing a beaded headband, a peace symbol necklace, and a large, paint-splattered shirt. When she pointed at me, I noticed her wrinkled hands were covered in paint, too.
"I don't believe you were invited in," she said.
"I just came to get my helicopter," I tried to explain.
"Chives!" she hollered. "Bring the child his toy."
Chives came clomping down the wooden stairs and handed me my helicopter. He put it on a silver tray.
"There," said Viola Dots, "you have it. Now leave."
This woman was not someone I wanted to argue with. She scared me. It looked like she hadn't smiled in 50 years.
"On my way, ma'am," I said. "By the way, that's a fantastic frame you have there."
"Indeed it is," she said. "Now, as I was saying, goodbye." I turned to leave. To my surprise, Luna stayed back. That girl would talk to anyone.
"Did you do all these paintings?" Luna asked Viola.
Viola Dots nodded her head, which made her dangling jeweled earrings sparkle like crystals, lights on the ceiling.
"You're a very good painter, Mrs. Dots," Luna said. "I paint, too, in my magic cave."
"Don't talk nonsense, child," Viola Dots answered. "I like what you're wearing," Luna went on in a friendly, chatty way. "Your headband is cool, and I especially love your earrings. I collect glittery stuff, too, just like you."
Viola didn't answer, but that didn't seem to bother Luna one bit. She chatted right on.
"And I make lots of beautiful things, like capes and jewelry and costumes."
Luna was talking a mile a minute now. "See this feather hat?
Want to see it close up?" Before Viola could say no, Luna walked right up to her. "I collected these feathers from all over the neighborhood, except some of them my grandma bought me at a thrift store. And then I rearranged them to look like a bird I saw in my dreams." Viola listened impatiently, not smiling, but not exactly frowning either. I looked over at Chives. He was definitely smiling, at least as much as a pig can smile.
"Your creations are indeed lovely, young miss," he said to Luna.
I still couldn't believe those words were coming from a talking pig.
"Some of the kids at school make fun of what I wear," Luna said, "but I don't care. I like to be original."
"Yes," Viola Dot said, taking a step toward one of her paintings. "All art requires originality."
"Maybe you can come over to my house sometime," Luna said to Viola.
You like to make art, and so do I. I can show you all my supplies." Viola looked surprised.
"Come to your house," she repeated.
"That's impossible."
"Madame Dots does not leave the house," Chives explained. "She hasn't been outside in over 50 years now, not since the day her son David disappeared."
"Disappeared? What happened to him?" The question flew out of my mouth before I could stop it.
"I don't speak of that day," Viola said.
"Never.
Now go, and let me be."
I headed for the door. Luna followed me for a few steps, but then she turned and went back to Viola. She reached out and took Viola's paint-splattered hands. Viola seemed shocked, but she didn't pull her hands away.
"My grandmother says that everything feels worse when you keep it deep inside," Luna said.
"Perhaps the child is right, madam," Chive said. "Perhaps it is time we spoke of it." Viola Dots shook her head.
"There are so many memories," she said. "So many questions and so few answers."
She went over to the frame and ran her hand along the carvings. She reached up and touched the tiger, following its stripes with her finger.
"I remember that awful day, as if it were yesterday," she said.
And then Viola Dots took out a handkerchief, dabbed at her eyes, and started to speak.